Hello friends, welcome to a new topic today. In this chapter, we are going to learn about acute osteomyelitis. So if you see in acute osteomyelitis, what is the most common site of acute osteomyelitis? In that, metaphysis is the most common site of acute osteomyelitis. And this metaphysis is the most common site and it is also the first affected in acute osteomyelitis. Why is metaphysis first affected? If you were asked the causes of why metaphysis is first affected, this is because here in metaphysis there is depleted reticuloendothelial system, there is high vascularity, there is pin hair loop system. Okay, there is high vascularity, that is pin hair loop system of blood vessels are present. Here microtrauma is more commonly occurs here. What is this pin hairpin loop system? Here you see the blood vessels which are arranged like this loop like patterns, and this is called as hairpin loop system of blood vessels. So because of these loops of blood vessels which are seen, this will lead to stasis of circulation and thus leading to infection being and thus it is a site of infection in metaphysis. Okay, then in the metaphysis, what is the overall most common site in adults? The overall most common site in adults is vertebral body. Vertebral body is the most common site of having this osteomyelitis in adult. Then what is the most common joint involved? If you were asked what is the most common joint involved, the most common joint involved is the knee joint. Okay, then if you were asked about the organisms, what is the most common organism involved? If you see, overall most common organism which is involved in osteomyelitis is Staphylococcal aureus. Okay, then what about the most common organ which is involved in sickle cell anemia? In sickle cell anemia, most common organ involved is Salmonella typhi. What about the most common organ involved in IV drug abusers? In IV drug abusers, most common organism involved is Pseudomonas. Then most common organism involved in human bites is Eichenella. Most common organism involved in animal bites is we have Pasteurella. Most common organism involved in acute, subacute, open and chronic open injuries is Staphylococcal aureus. So these are the different most common organisms which are involved in osteomyelitis. See, this is the picture of osteomyelitis. Okay, actually it's not so clear, but anyways I'll just show you even more. Fine, so if you see, we will see how will we diagnose this osteomyelitis. So if you see in osteomyelitis, if there is a first symptom is there will be fever, swelling, absent movement in child. Whenever there is fever, swelling, absent movement in child, this absent movement can be absent in movement of limb. The limb cannot be moving properly, or the movement absence is in the joint. Okay, if it is joint, then we are not doing it now. All this is not in osteomyelitis. If there is absence of movement of limb, then we can call it is osteomyelitis of Staphylococcal aureus in a child. In a child, absence of movement of limb, you will have a suspicion of osteomyelitis. Now you will have to divide whether the osteomyelitis is less than 24 hours or more than 24 hours. So if the osteomyelitis is less than 24 hours, then you will have to get an X-ray done and MRI changes seen. If X-ray is normal and MRI changes are seen in the marrow, then you will have to put the baby on antibiotics for 6 weeks. Okay, then if the osteomyelitis is if the occurrence of the disease has already been crossed more than 24 hours, then in X-ray you will see loss of soft tissue planes, and in MRI you will see changes in the marrow. In such cases, even if you do surgery, antibiotics, it will not be sufficient because the pus has already been formed. So as a result, you should do antibiotics for 6 weeks followed by surgery. Okay, so once the condition improves after doing the treatment, after giving antibiotics, once the condition improves, the CRP returns to normal. Once the condition improves, for CRP to return to normal, it takes 2 weeks. So within 2 weeks, CRP, that is C-reactive protein, returns to normal in 2 weeks usually. antibiotics orally for 4 weeks. After antibiotics orally for 4 weeks, you will see the CRP to come to normal. Okay, then MRI changes. So if you see in investigations, for MRI changes to occur, these MRI changes occur within 6 hours of infection, whereas bone scan changes occur within 12 hours of infection. MRI changes occur within 6 hours of infection. Bone scan changes occur within 12 hours of infection. X-ray changes occur within 24 hours of infection. So earliest change is seen in MRI. Okay, MRI changes in 6 hours, bone scan changes in 12 hours, and X-ray changes in 24 hours. Then what about the osteomyelitis if it occurs in newborn? Okay, osteomyelitis in newborn, if you see, in newborn, what is the most common organism involved in osteomyelitis of newborn? That is Staphylococcal aureus. Where is it seen? It is seen mainly in the metaphysis. Okay, it is most commonly seen in metaphysis. What is the mechanism of spread? That is hematogenous. Here it is due to hematogenous spread, and it also can have multifocal spread. And what is seen in here, there will be paucity to clinical signs. You won't see classic clinical signs of osteomyelitis like fever, tenderness of joints. Okay, all those will not, tachycardia, all those will not be seen. Why? Because newborns have less immunity. So as a result, even though the organism is present in the newborns, it does not give proper immune reaction. And as a result, you won't see the clinical signs. Then here you in newborns especially, it has poor prognosis. It is associated with poor prognosis. Then if you see, we will see types of osteomyelitis. Osteomyelitis are divided into mainly three major types. We have acute osteomyelitis, in which the disease is less than 2 weeks. Then subacute osteomyelitis, where the disease is in 2 to 3 weeks. Chronic osteomyelitis, where the disease has been crossed 3 weeks. Okay, so these are important according to terminology. Then we have something called as Brody's abscess. Okay, in Brody's abscess, if you see, this is the Brody's abscess. You can clearly see the abscess, which is most commonly seen in the tibia. Okay, this is Brody's abscess. What is Brody's abscess? Brody's abscess is mainly the subacute osteomyelitis. It mainly includes the subacute osteomyelitis more commonly than chronic osteomyelitis. Where do you see this Brody's abscess? This is mainly located in the upper end of tibia. This is the upper end of tibia where you see the Brody's abscess. Here we see this has a lytic lesion with sclerotic margin. It is seen as lytic lesion with sclerotic margin, which is seen in immunocompetent host. So this is lytic lesion and this is sclerotic margin. Okay, you see lytic lesion with sclerotic margin in immunocompromised host. This is Brody's abscess, which you will see in the diagram. Then we have the next important type of osteomyelitis is chronic osteomyelitis. So what is the causative organism of this chronic osteomyelitis? If you were asked that, chronic osteomyelitis, the causative organism is Staphylococcal aureus. Okay, then in chronic osteomyelitis, we have some definitions. That is, sequestrum is associated with chronic osteomyelitis. What is this sequestrum? Sequestrum is avascular plane of bone, avascular piece of bone which is surrounded by granulation tissue. This is avascular. It does not have any blood supply. That part of bone without surrounded by granulation tissue. Here you can see this has sequestrum, where it is surrounded by granulation tissue and it is a avascular piece of bone. We have some more. That is, we have something called as involucrum. What is this involucrum? This involucrum is a dense sclerotic new bone. It is new bone which is surrounding the sequestrum. This is surrounding the sequestrum. This is dense sclerotic new bone. New bone which is surrounding the sequestrum is involucrum. This is not seen here. Anyways, then we have one more nomenclature which is important, which is called as cloaca. What is this cloaca? Cloaca is a sinus through the involucrum. The sinus which is seen through the involucrum is the cloaca. Cloaca is the sinus through the involucrum. Then these are important one-liners. Just you should remember their names. That's it. Nothing more is important. Next, what are the complications of acute osteomyelitis? So if you were asked the complications of chronic osteomyelitis, the main complication is there can be amyloidosis formation and it is associated with malignancy. Most commonly, it is associated with squamous cell carcinoma. Complications are, it is associated with amyloidosis, malignancy, most commonly squamous cell carcinoma. At least if you see, 2/3 of the surface of sequestrum should be surrounded by involucrum. If there is a sequestrum, at least 2/3 of this sequestrum should be surrounded by involucrum before carrying out the sequestrectomy. See, sequestrum is a dead bone, right? If this is the dead bone, okay, this dead bone should be surrounded by involucrum, which is a new bone which is formed. If 2/3 of it is supplied by involucrum, then you can remove this sequestrum, okay, and as a result, this newborn involucrum which is formed, that will cover the whole cavity, right? This is involucrum, this is sequestrum. Only then you should do sequestrectomy. Now, if you see treatment of this condition. So, if you see treatment of this condition, treatment is, first we will have to remove the sequestrum, okay, which is called as, we can do sequestrectomy. Sequestrectomy is nothing but removal of sequestrum, that is removal of dead bone. Okay, when you are removing this dead bone, there should be presence of live bone beneath the dead bone. Whenever there is live bone beneath the dead bone, that is the reason why you should wait. At least 2/3 of sequestrum is covered by involucrum, because involucrum is the new bone, right? So this new bone should be there, okay, and because this sequestrum you are removing, and surrounding this sequestrum you have new bone. New bone always has good blood supply, right? Because new bone has good blood supply, so this will lead to the bleeding, and this type of bone, I mean bleeding, this will lead to the bleeding, and this is called a sign which is called as Parika sign. Okay, what is this Parika sign? Parika sign is the presence of bleeding from live bone underneath the dead bone. Beneath the dead bone, the bleeding which you see in the live bone is called as Parika sign. Okay, then here one more important thing is, you should control the infection. Okay, the most important step is control the infection, for which you should give the antibiotics, then fill the gap using the bone grafting. You should use bone grafting and fill the gap. You can use either iliac crest, or you can use, that is iliac crest, or you can use bone cement. Here bone cement is polymethyl methacrylate, can be used. Okay, by this you should fill the gap. Okay, this is therapy. Then you can also use one new therapy which can be used recently, is called as negative pressure wound therapy. There is something called as negative pressure wound therapy or vacuum assisted closure. Negative wound pressure therapy or vacuum assisted closure can also be done. Here what do we do? Here we do vacuum dressings. Okay, here we do vacuum dressings, and the which is surrounding the wound. Okay, this vacuum dressings will help in healing of the wound, okay, by removal of excess fluid. Because it is vacuum dressing, it has a suction pressure, so it removes the excess fluid from the wound, and thus it helps in healing. Okay, what suction pressure should it have? It should have a pressure of at least 75 to 125 millimeters of Hg of suction pressure should be there. It can be given either continuously or intermittently. It gives good granulation tissue. Okay, there are some contraindications of this therapy. It is mainly contraindicated in, these are very important, whenever there is malignancy, untreated osteomyelitis, okay, necrotic escher. Whenever there is malignancy, untreated osteomyelitis or necrotic escher, these are the contraindications of negative pressure wound therapy or vacuum assisted closure. What are the contraindications? Malignancy, untreated osteomyelitis, necrotic escher. These can also be used for pressure sore. Okay, so this is about negative pressure assisted closure. Then, if you see, this is the picture of a bone cutter. How are you saying that this is bone cutter? See the sharp edge here. Here it is sharp, right? So by that sharp edge, which is used for cutting the bone, so that is bone cutter. Here nibbler. See, this is not sharp. It has some, you know, wide. It is wider, right? It is not sharp and thin. It is wider. So this is bone nibbler. It helps in nibbling of the bone. Then we see. We will learn about few more osteomyelitis. So there is one more osteomyelitis which is called as Garry's osteomyelitis. What is this Garry's osteomyelitis? It is a type of chronic osteomyelitis only, but this is involving the segments of the bone. It won't involve the complete bone. It will just involve the segment of the bone. What is it? Where is it most commonly seen? This Garry's osteomyelitis is most commonly seen in mandible, followed by tibia. This is Garry's osteomyelitis. Then after this, we have a syndrome which is called as Sapho's syndrome. What does this Sapho's syndrome represent? See, this Sapho's syndrome is S for synovitis, A for acne, P for pustulosis, H for hyperostosis or thickened bone, osteitis, that is inflamed bone. Okay, here we have this is Sapho's syndrome, which includes synovitis, acne, pustulosis, P for pustulosis, H for hyperostosis, that is thickened bone, O for osteitis, which is inflamed bone. Okay, here this is also called as chronic recurrent multifocal osteomyelitis, but it is a misnomer because here it is not multifocal osteomyelitis. It is not caused due to an infection, but it is an autoimmune disease, which is caused by HLA-B27 positive, and it is an autoimmune disease. How are you going to treat it? It should be treated by as any other autoimmune disease with NSAIDs, or it can be treated with steroids and DMARDs. You can use either NSAIDs or steroids or DMARDs to treat the disease. This is Sapho's syndrome. Okay, next. If you were asked what is the most common, this is chronic recurrent multifocal osteomyelitis. It is just a misnomer which is given, but there is something called as multifocal osteomyelitis also. What is the causes, most common cause of multifocal osteomyelitis? The most common cause of multifocal osteomyelitis is salmonella. Okay, salmonella is the most common cause of multifocal osteomyelitis. Then this is about the osteomyelitis. Thank you guys for watching my lecture. In the next class, we will see joint and soft tissue infection. Thank you.